Our case study of peripheral arterial disease is about a 52-year-old woman with a 40-year history of type 1 diabetes mellitus. The patient also has a history of intermittent claudication. What's intermittent claudication? Pain in the lower extremities on exertion that is relieved by rest. The patient is presenting with a non-healing wound in the right foot. There is a wound in the right foot. Why doesn't it want to heal? Because there is ischemia. There is not sufficient blood supply. That's why it's taking that wound a long time to heal. The right dorsalis pedis artery and the right posterior tibial artery pulses were not palpable. Definitely ischemia. Ankle brachial test results. Look at this. On the left side, the left brachial systolic pressure, 130. The left ankle systolic pressure, 110. How come? It's less than the upper limb. There should be a problem. On the right side, the right brachial systolic pressure, 125. Look at the right ankle systolic pressure, 75. Much, much lower. And here the difference is much more than 10%. Here it is significant, as we're going to see. Angiography showed right tibial artery obstruction. Then the patient underwent successful percutaneous angioplasty of the diseased vessel and placement of a stent to restore blood flow, and of course, her wound healed properly. So let's do some questions. First question, identify this patient's two most critical risk factors for peripheral arterial disease. What are the risk factors in this particular patient? The patient's two most critical risk factors for peripheral arterial disease are definitely diabetes mellitus and hypertension. She has 40-year history of type 1 diabetes and she is hypertensive. Both of them are very important risk factors for the process of atherosclerosis that results in peripheral arterial disease as well as in ischemic heart disease. A very important thing to note, whenever you have atherosclerosis in an artery, you know that all your body arteries have atherosclerosis and sooner or later they are going to present with ischemic symptoms, whether in the cuff, intermittent claudication, or in the heart as heart attacks and angina, or even in the brain as cerebral strokes. Second question, what level of peripheral arterial disease is suggested by her pulse examination? Is it iliac, femoral, superficial femoral, or tibial artery disease? Per examination, the pulse examination suggests that peripheral arterial disease exists at the level of the tibial artery, at the level of the tibial artery. Question 4, what conclusions can be drawn from the ankle brachial test results? How can you know? How can you interpret the ankle brachial test results? The right ankle brachial index is 0.6, which is a sign of severe obstruction, The circulation to the lower limb is very much reduced. On the left side, it is the index is 0.85, and this suggests significant peripheral arterial disease also in the left leg. Question 6, what major conclusions can be drawn from the patient's blood work? Lab work. What can you conclude from her lab work? If you look at her CBC, there is an elevated white blood cell count, an elevated erythrocyte sedimentation rate, ESR. Why was that? Because both are consistent with infection and inflammation. Don't forget, she has a wound that does not heal, and it gets infected and inflamed. Also, the elevated neutrophil percentage in the white blood cell differential count is consistent with a bacterial infection. The stress of infection has resulted in poor blood glucose control. That's why her blood sugar kind of on the higher level. Cortisol and catecholamines released in times of illness and stress will trigger hepatic gluconeogenesis and glycogenolysis. And finally, the patient's lipid profile is also poor. The total cholesterol is very high. LDL, low density lipoprotein, or the bad cholesterol is also elevated, and the high density lipoprotein, the good cholesterol, is low. All are significant risk factors for atherosclerosis. So based on the information provided in the patient's clinical workup, what type of medication is ultimately necessary? Of course, hyperlipidemia, which is a major risk factor for peripheral arterial disease, needs to be managed. So the patient's poor lipid profile will definitely need some lipid-lowering drugs, and the best are, so far, statins. Why is it unlikely that a thrombus or embolus contributed to the arterial obstruction in this case? And the key word here, if the obstruction is the result of an embolus, it should have been very sudden. So obstruction in an extremity by a thrombus or embolus causes sudden onset of acute pain with numbness, tingling, weakness, and pallor. These changes are followed rapidly by cyanosis, mottling of the skin, and the loss of sensory reflex and motor functions in the affected extremity. This syndrome of clinical manifestations was not observed in this patient. Of course, the incidence was kind of gradual in this patient. Furthermore, a normal electrocardiogram indicates that a cardiac cause of embolism, which is the most common cause of arterial emboli, is highly unlikely.